Blacks in Technology.
Blacks in Technology. Blacks in Technology. Blacks in Technology. Blacks in Technology. Blacks in Technology.
All right. Welcome, everybody, to the Blacks in Technology audio podcast. This is episode number 30. This is Greg Greenlee, owner and founder of the Blacks in Technology website. You can check us out at www.blacksintechnology.net. You can also follow us on Twitter at Black in Technology, and that is BLKTECHNOLOGY. You can also check us up on Facebook, Blacks in Technology, as well as we have a LinkedIn group under the same moniker, Blacks in Technology. It is May 27th, Sunday, late evening, 11:25 Eastern Standard Time. And tonight I actually have a guest on the show tonight. He comes he's on the West Coast, Seattle, Washington. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. By way of Dallas, Texas, by way of Nigeria. This gentleman, very interesting background in technology, and we're going to get into his story and his background as well as his app that is looking to pretty much change the world, and it's a very interesting app. We're going to get into that as well, so I want to introduce Chuks Onwuneme. Is that correct, the last name?
Chuks Onwuneme.
Okay, Onwuneme. Okay. Thanks for joining us tonight on the Blacks in Technology podcast. Definitely appreciate you being on.
Yeah, not a problem.
Just to give a little background on how we met, I actually met Chuks down at South by Southwest in Austin back in, what was that, March, I think it was, March we met. He actually provided me with a T-shirt. Thanks for that. I do wear that T-shirt quite often. I actually had a couple of people inquire about getting those T-shirts. I guess they thought that I sold the T-shirts myself, and I had to let them know that I got them as a gift. There's a couple of guys on Google Plus that I actually took a pic of me wearing the T-shirt, and I posted it on Google Plus, and there was a couple of inquiries about the T-shirt.
Oh, how cool.
Yeah, so I always try to represent, man. Anybody who has a good cause, you know, that's into technology, that's working towards expanding that visibility, especially amongst Black technologists, I definitely like to always represent them. So anytime
I appreciate it, Greg.
No problem. So, Chuks, you were born in Nigeria. Let's get some background into your journey into IT. You had a very interesting background. You sent me a bio and I was reading it, and I was kind of like blown away. I was like, this guy is practically, or he is a genius. So I definitely want you to give the listeners out there some a vision into your background.
Oh, yeah, sure. That's kind of like the first time I'm being described with a G word, but I'll defer that to the smarter people. Yeah, but I mean, you know, my journey has been more so, you know, one of determination. I mean, like you said correctly, I was born in Nigeria, and I guess for me, from an early age, I was really around, you know, a lot of technical people. My dad is an engineer, and you know, I grew up in this place where, you know, they have a lot of engineers. You know, my dad was one of the engineers who worked in this, you know, steel company, which was one of Africa's premier steel company back in the days. And this steel company was built by a lot of you know, foreign engineers. So I grew up in that mix of of European, American, African engineers. And, you know, at a very early age, I used to always wonder, you know, why these guys are so smart. I mean, you know, I remember being six and asking my dad, you know, like, how come these guys are so smart? I mean, I just saw a lot of guys, you know, building stuff, you know, and you know, it really inspired me, you know, especially seeing, you know, folks like my dad just, fixing a lot of things, right? So I just thought from that age, you know, I just want to build stuff, right? You know, but I remember when I got into elementary school back then, you know, my mom had told me, actually she gave me a challenge, right? You know, she told me, I went to this really prestigious school back there, and she had told me, you know, if I came top 20 out of a class of 144 people, you know, she's got something really special for me, right? And I ended up that first semester coming up fifth. And I'm like, wow, I mean, you know, if I could place fifth, right? I mean, yeah. There's really no reason why I can't place first, you know? So,
yeah.
I mean, you should realize in the cultural aspect of Nigeria, I mean, academic performance was worth a lot more and you know, than anything else, you know. In the society over there, I mean, if you did well in school, that's it. You know, everyone just really wanted to do very well in school, right? My thing just became, you know, I want to be first, you know, and I just really got into that mode where, you know, I just turned myself into a geek and a nerd, just studying and doing everything I could, you know, until when I finished up high school, I was literally, you know, the top student, you know, and after that, I really got into computers. I remember getting into computers right before I finished up high school. At the time, you know, no one else was doing computers, right? But I knew at that age that I was going to do something with computers. When I was done in high school, I had all these really awesome grades and everything, and you know, at the time, there wasn't really a place to study computer science in Nigeria. So, you know, my thing was if I needed to do something with my life, I had to leave the country, you know, and it was very common. I mean, most of my high school buddies, you know, all left. Either came over to the U.S. or to England. So those were my options. But the problem was, you know, I didn't have any money. So I knew I had to go figure out a way to find my way out here. You know, so.
Let me stop you right there, because this is a testament just to your work ethic. You placed fifth in your 95th percentile,
right?
In the 95th percentile, and a lot of people would have been okay with that. They would have been fifth is good. And they would have been, that's fine. And although that's still very good by a lot of people's standards, you did not accept that. That wasn't where you stopped. You wanted more than that. And
right.
That even leads up into when you actually were thinking about leaving, or you knew that you were going to leave Nigeria and make your way to either United States, Canada, or England, and how you went about. You said you didn't have the money. So to tell us about how you went about, because this is amazing in itself. A lot of people wouldn't have taken it or went that extra mile just to, you know, pursue their education further. I mean, because you were already, tops in your high school. You were valedictorian. You were one of the best you competed nationally in computer programming contests. You placed second. So talk about what you did in order to raise money and to get over to the United States.
Well, first, I guess for me, right, from all my experiences, right, I never take no for an answer, especially if it's something I know I've set my eyes at. If I have a goal, basically, I never take no for an answer. I mean, I'll stop at nothing, you know, until I achieve that goal. And usually, you know, I mean, my wife tells me this a lot. I mean, I sometimes beat myself up a lot, just, you know, if I don't achieve, you know, a goal that I really set out for myself. So, you know, when I finished high school, you know, I had all these really awesome, great assets, you know, like an academic record in our GCE O-levels. No one prior to me had ever made the grade I made, you know, so I had all this great stuff, and I knew that wasn't the end, right? I mean, I just felt it, you know. I knew I just had to keep on going. So what I did was, you know, I traveled to the city of Lagos, which is, you know, one of the most popular cities in Nigeria. That's really where everything happened. It's like the economic capital of the country. Kind of like a New York, right? And I just walked the streets. I mean, literally, I was, you know, I was 16 years old, and, you know, I had my grades in my hand, one hand, and on the other hand, I was just knocking on every single door. I mean, I went to every single office, you know. I literally, I was nuts. My thing was, and I had a pitch. My pitch was pretty simple, right? Anybody I met, I told them, hey, you know, I want to go out. I don't care where I was going to go. You know, I could go to the U.S. or Canada or the U.K. I want to study computer science, and I knew, you know, I wanted to do something good with that for the world. And, you know, here is evidence that I'm not just bluffing, right? I've spent the past 6 years of my life, you know, building this thing up. And everybody I talked to, really, at that time, they listened to me, but, you know, the funds were, you know, were kind of difficult to come by. And so what really happened was, you know, at first, you know, it was just, I call it, you know, stroke of luck, right? I came by the right person at the time who literally, you know, heard me out. And he was like, you've never seen anyone who's got this much determination, and he was going to do it for me, right? And at the time, I had applied to, so I had written to seven colleges in the U.S. Basically, I had, so we had no family here in the U.S., so I had no guidance at all, right? And people, you know, ask me how I ended up in Texas. Well, I have no idea, basically. So what I did was, you know, I wrote to seven universities in the U.S., and they all sent me back all of the requirements. I sat for the SAT. I pretty much made almost perfect scores. So I had everything it took to enter any university anywhere, right? But all those guys were really interested in was, you know, I remember MIT, they sent me this insane, you know, I needed to have $50,000 a year or whatever. And, you know, literally all the colleges were just like, you know, it's going to cost me like, you know, 30, 40, 50 grand to go to college there. And, I mean,
yeah.
Let me put things in perspective. Like, that money would feed the entire town for a whole year where I grew up in Nigeria. That just kind of gives you the perspective of, you know, what that meant. So it was impossible, you know, it was impossible to have that kind of money. But only one university wrote me back, and they told me they had scholarships, right? And you know, when I saw the word scholarship, I'm like, that's it. You know, that's where I'm going. And it just happened to be the University of Texas in Arlington. So guess what? That's the only university I applied to. I got accepted. You know, but I had to go over. I had to find a way to fund my going over. So, I mean, you know, after walking the streets of Lagos and meeting the right people, I finally met a couple of guys who you know, became sponsors for me. And, you know, with the backing of my family, I ended up in Texas. And, you know, life really started for me out there in Dallas. This is about 15 years ago.
Wow. Very, very, very interesting, very inspiring. And definitely motivational. That's an awesome story.
yeah.
Just, I mean,
yeah,
just,
no, yeah. It was, I guess it was a mixture of, you know, I was just nuts with determination. I mean, there was just nothing that could stop me at that point, really. You know, it was that bad that I couldn't even see the possibility of this thing not happening, of, you know, by not going to college and studying, you know, computer science. I didn't even consider that was a possibility. You know, I just knew it was going to happen somehow. And you know, I had the faith, I had the conviction, I had the determination, and I was going to stop at nothing. I didn't care if it was going to cost me, if it was going to take me 2, 3, 4, 5 years. I mean, it took me a year. I spent, you know, a year after high school just, you know, doing this, you know. So.
Wow. So you're at the University of Texas, and you're in their engineering program.
Right.
How was that? What was that experience like being
at
your
I loved it. I mean, I'll just give a shout out right now to anybody who is considering, you know, studying engineering. UT Arlington, highly, highly recommended. I love that place, you know. I went over there and, you know, all of a sudden I met, like, a bunch of really cool people. Right from the time I landed at the airport, Dallas-Fort Worth, the university had sent over somebody to pick me up from the airport. I mean, hey, guess what? I was a 17-year-old kid who just got here. I knew nobody. And I knew I was coming here for a purpose, you know. But, I mean, I had a really great experience. The school had arranged for somebody to come pick me up at the airport. You know, so it was really welcoming. They had a really great international community, which I totally loved because I just felt like home, like, all of a sudden. I just met a lot of people from, also from Nigeria, from all over Africa, from all over Europe, Asia, just all over. It was a really great, 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 awesome environment for me. So I felt, you know, very much at home. And, you know, the programs were totally awesome and very challenging. You know, but I loved every bit of it.
Excellent. So you started programming around the age of 14. Is that?
Yes.
What language did you start off in?
Basic.
Basic. Wow.
Yeah, this was back in the days when so my high school at the time, they had just introduced computers. You know, it was pretty much one of the first high schools in Nigeria at the time who, you know, that had a computer program. So, you know, I saw this thing and it was really awesome. And I was like, you know what? I mean, that's what I want to do. And you know, I got into it like right away and learned basic programming, DOS, and a bunch of other really cool stuff back then. And you know, I saw a lot of feature in it at the time.
Nice. Tell me about maybe an early something, one of your very first programs that you wrote that you were just like extremely proud of. What's one of those programs that may still stand out in your mind that you were like, man, I can't believe I wrote that program back then. This was something I was proud of.
Let's see if I can remember. You mean back then or recently?
Yeah, like in your earlier programming days.
Let's see if I remember any of that. So, I think it was one of the early programs I did that basically, what did it do? So there were a bunch of files that actually it was the contest we had done, computer science programming contest we had done. What we had to do was basically search for, certain strings in a file, and that was a big deal back then because, you know, if you're familiar with, like, the DOS system, right, and BASIC, I mean, that's something like a big deal back then, you know. But, you know, I was able to figure it out. I mean, it was, you know, a combination of, like, you know, hacking and just doing a bunch of trials and a bunch of things, you know, that we came by the solution and, you know, finding a couple of strings in a file. Today it might sound like, you know, something really dumb, right? I mean, but back then, you know, a bunch of kids who, like, you know, had no clue what they were doing, you know, had to figure everything out. And, you know, the first thing to figure it out, you know, basically won that contest. And I was one of the guys who actually got it out. So.
Nice. So, you obviously have a ton of self-motivation and a fire that keeps you going and keeps you striving for your goals. Besides your parents, which seems that they sounds like they were a big influence in your life as far as you know, direction and things like that. Your father was an engineer. Your mother was a school administrator. What else or who else inspires you?
Well, at that early age, basically, I think it was, you know, you're right, my parents. But also, I was like my parents' friends, right? We're really in the same circles, right? I mean, they're all engineers, and just being around smart people was very inspirational for me. Because, you know, my thing is, I always never want to feel that I am the smartest person in the room. I always want to know that there's someone out there who I can, you know, learn from. And just being around people, you know, like that is really inspirational to me. And really that's what kind of kept me grounded growing up, right? Because I was always really around people who were like that, right? My friends, I mean, we were all nuts. I mean, we were like, you know, like a nerd herd, you know? It was so crazy. I mean, I remember they even had to they had to put us in special classes because, you know, when we were in the regular classes, you know, it was just really boring because all the things that they would, you know, teach in the regular classes, these are things that we had covered, like, you know, the semester earlier. And it wasn't just me, right? I mean, it was a bunch of us, right? And just being around those people, right, was my thing. I always wanted you know, I was 14, 15 years old, you know, back then, and basically every day my dream was to go to class and bring up a topic that had not even been considered by any of my peers so we could have a debate on some, you know, physics or some math or some, you know, science or chemistry issue. You know, that was my thing, and it was totally nuts that that's what we did.
I mean, that's a very good point because – I wrote a, it was almost like a how-to, like if someone wanted to get into technology or wanted to get into, you know, information technology, it was kind of my how-to on how I got into it. And one of the things that I listed was, you know, hang with the geeks. If you want to learn... If you need to be in the know, or if you want to learn, or you want to want knowledge, hang with the people that are smarter than you, right?
Yeah.
And you know, just listen, get information, ask questions, and just hang with those people because those are the people that you're gonna, you know, learn from or pull information from. So mm-hmm. I definitely understand that aspect.
And, you know, the last thing really carried, you know, throughout my life, you know, when I, obviously people ask me this stuff, like, you know, if I ever, you know, did the regular things, you know, keep at that age deep, and I'm like, well, to me, you know, life was all about learning at that point, right? I wasn't really thinking of anything else than just, you know, learning beyond my means, you know? You know, when I got to college and stuff, it was exactly the same thing. I really looked out for people who I could hang out with, people, you know, who I could learn from. You know, it also carried along with, you know, finding a life partner as well. I mean, I wanted, you know, really the exact same, you know, characteristics as well. You know, someone I could really learn from. And, you know, someone who was smarter than me myself, you know, so, you know, my wife happens to be a chemical engineer, so it was something I that really got me really, really attracted to, you know, things like that. I mean, you know,
yeah,
that's
I mean,
who
that's,
I am. And
yeah, I definitely understand. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I came or grew created and founded the Blacks in Technology community site is because of the need amongst the Black culture to have that type of unity, to have that community and that atmosphere where we can go and we can exchange ideas and we can share knowledge and we can talk, you know, technology. amongst ourselves, because sometimes when it comes down to it, a lot of it is, you know, who you're comfortable with talking to, you know. And I found, you know, with throughout my years in IT, that sometimes that's all it boils down to is people not being comfortable talking to or bringing up a topic, you know, to where they might even they might feel, you know, kind of like a, you know, kind of like a, I guess a outcast, I guess, amongst a crowd of people. So I mean, the site is there just for that. So, you know, you want to learn some things. You want to learn about technology. You can come and you can be comfortable amongst people that that look, talk, walk, dress, whatever, like you, and you can talk technology. So, you know, I definitely understand that aspect of it.
Very true. I mean, knowledge is not a monopoly. That's one thing I learned, you know, especially today with the internet. Knowledge is not a monopoly, you know. Back in the days, I guess, you know, knowledge was kept from certain people. But today, it's not, you know, basically, it depends on really what you want in life. You know what I mean? Like even today, going to college, right, sometimes I even question, you know, going to college and just sitting down to learn something, because, you know, if you're so motivated, you could learn like a whole bunch of things by just reading and just researching yourself and just, you know, talking to people who are, you know, who are in the know. And there's nothing that should stop you, you know. It's like, I still remember, you know, my entry into our yearbook back in high school. And what I said was a quote that I had, you know, come up with, right? And it was, I think it was, you know, pursue knowledge like a sinking star far beyond the reaches of human imagination. You know, so it's kind of like if you consider, you know, the sun setting, like, you know, you're just pursuing that sun, right? You know, it goes beyond the horizon, but you want to go farther than that. You know, you just want to figure out that, you know, the horizon is not the end. There's something beyond that horizon, you know, and if you have that piece of mind to go figure it out, then there's nothing, you know, stopping you.
Yeah, that's definitely a good quote. I definitely like that. So now you're you graduated from University of Texas with honors, and you are an engineer at Nokia. Tell us about that.
I worked there for 9 years. Actually, I'm no longer there. I was there for about 9 years.
Okay.
Totally, totally awesome experience I had, because, you know, it really gave me the opportunity to see the world. As you know, Nokia is, based in Finland, Northern Europe. And, you know, I did a lot of travel out there throughout my years. Just, you know, getting to work with really, really smart people. And when I look back at those years, I think about the smartphone revolution and you know, I think back to the fact that, you know, we literally started it, you know. I mean, when Apple came into the game in 07, a lot of people today remember Apple as that company who came up and to their credit, you know, made the smartphone what it is today. But, you know, we were working on smartphones way, way before that. And, you know, we had somewhat of a monopoly back in the days, you know. And just being amongst, you know, Nokia's global army of engineers who built, you know, the insanely successful Symbian smartphone. That was a really, really awesome experience I had. And it's unfortunate the way Symbian sort of, you know, is literally disappeared. But, I mean, just being a part of that revolution was something that I would really cherish for the rest of my life.
Wow. Wow. That's, They're using Windows or mobile OS now, but it sounds like they're trying to mount some type of comeback, at least on the hardware side of it, with the Lumia 900.
Yeah, and I have it. I mean, you know, it's kind of hard for me to pick up any mobile device that's not a Nokia device, you know? It was my sweat and blood. I put in for 9 years building smartphones and Nokia. So I'm not there anymore, but most of the guys I work with are the same guys who are building the Lumia devices today. I'm really hoping, you know, the company could make a huge comeback. It's a steep hill to climb, but, you know, hopefully there'll be there's enough space for a third major player besides iOS and Android. So, you know.
definitely. So now we get to personify.
Yes, sir.
That's what we came to hear. That's what we came to talk about, really. So let me have you tell us what Personify is, and then we'll after because it's beyond a great app that it is. There is a great social cause behind this, and the reason why I mention that is because I love it when people fuse technology around doing something for the benefit, you know, of humanity, so to speak, or doing it for a great cause, and not, you know, and it's not just for, you know, making tons of gobs of money. Of course, that's always nice, but the social cause, the social aspect behind it is incredible, and I love hearing, you know, stories like these or hearing about applications like these that can do that. So tell us about Personify.
Well, one-liner, Personify really is an app that lets you discover what social good or volunteer opportunities are happening around you at any given time, anywhere you are in the world. That's really what Personify is, right? But there's a huge story behind it, and Personify really, and I'm not trying to mince words here, Personify really personifies my life and the experiences I have gone through in my journey. And every single person in this world, right, can tell that same story. Everyone has got a story. And what we're trying to do basically is to let the world know that we all share a common humanity. No matter who you are, where you're from, how old you are, and all of the various diversities we have on Earth, we all have a common humanity. And, you know, when I think about the work that we have done in technology, I think about the work I personally have been involved with at Nokia. I mean, Nokia literally owned the world at some point, right, with the devices we built. The thing that we have done had touched the lives of over a billion people on Earth. I mean, no other company, no other technology company has, maybe a few, but I can't think of any that right now, have really built a product that has singularly touched the lives of billions of people than the smartphone or the cell phone, right? So I'm thinking, you know, I mean, I traveled a lot, especially when I was at Nokia, and I'm seeing people, like, literally all over who are using products that we have designed. And I'm going, you know, I'm looking around me, and I'm seeing lots of problems in the world, right? These are things that, you know, simple things that, you know, that people can do to help. And nothing is being done. You know why? Because, you know, people don't know about these opportunities. But the thing is, you know, a lot of people want to do good, right? That's one thing that I have realized, you know. I believe everyone is inherently good, you know, but sometimes it's just, you know, circumstances, you know, around your surroundings or whatever it is that make people do whatever it is that they do. But you think about conflicts around the world. Think about all of the, you know, all of the bad things that happen all over, right? All of these things are caused by people not understanding each other, people not wanting to talk, not wanting to understand each other, right? If only we can show the world how similar we all are, right? I think half the problems in the world today will be solved. Just the conflicts alone will be solved, right? And I'm like, you know, what kind of vehicle can we use to bring people together? right? So over here, right, in my view, right, technology is not the end. Technology is a means towards an end. And my end, really, is to try to create a better world. You know, what if you could just look around you and figure out, hey, you know, I could be helping a neighbor down the street to do X, Y, Z. Or, you know, there's a kid down there who needs, you know, just a little bit of a help, right, in getting just a little bit, you know, work done. I mean, these are simple things that people really want to do, but they have no idea about those opportunities. So if you think about Craigslist, right, Craigslist is an insanely successful, you know, marketplace, right? It's a very simple site, but it's incredibly successful, you know? People go there, post stuff, buy stuff, do all that stuff. Like, I'm like, you know, how can we create that same environment, right, more or less so for social good? And really that's where the idea of personify comes about. Where you really don't have to go think about figuring out what to do, right, because, you know, you want to do stuff, right? What if those things came to you, right? What if your phone could just tell you, you know, let you know, things that are happening around you, right? You just say, hey, you know, I want to volunteer at, you know, at a soup kitchen, right? But what if your phone tells you, like, you know, you're traveling to New York, right, and your hotel, you're down there, you know, and your phone tells you, hey, down the street, you know, there's a soup kitchen that needs some help, right? I mean, would that give you a little bit more boost to go do it? Another insight I gave a friend just yesterday, I was talking, I was like, you know, what if you live next to your neighbor, right, who you think is a jerk for whatever reason. And then the next day or the next weekend, you go volunteer at some, you know, kids thing, whatever it is, and you saw that same neighbor there doing exactly the same thing that you're interested in doing. I mean, would that make you think a little bit differently about this neighbor?
Yeah.
Would that bring you guys a little bit together? And then all of the differences you had earlier all of a sudden disappears, right? I mean, you know, there's simple things that we can do in the world, right, that could bring the world together, you know, that could make people to talk and intermingle and socialize and have fun, right? When I came to the United States earlier, you know, I used to be disturbed by images I saw on TV about, you know, my country and other African countries, right? And those images were always projected as, you know, really poor people who needed, you know, help. And all these charities will try to tell you how you can give a dollar to save a kid's life in Africa. But I'm going, you know, it's funny because when I was in Dallas, right, I volunteered at a local community church food bank. And, you know, I saw a lot more hungry people than I ever saw growing up in Nigeria, right? And I'm going, you know, but why do we have to let people think that all these things are happening in faraway, you know, Africa or in faraway South America, you know?
Yeah.
But these things are happening everywhere, all around you. I'm not saying it's not happening over there. I'm just saying, you know, what if you can know, you can feel, you can see that your help, right, is needed where you are, anywhere you are, right? In a sense, it makes people sort of start thinking locally. You think globally, but you act local, right? And that's the whole idea, right? We're trying to start a movement and trying to build an army of do-gooders. You know, people who just want to do good, which I'm hoping, I assume, is really everybody, you know? you know, the more we bring people together around these things, you know, I truly believe, you know, it's a step in the direction of making the world together, bringing the world together, making the world a better place. And you know, technology in this sense, right, is just a vehicle. But the end goal really is about doing good and letting you know how you can do good, where you can do good, and, you know, having a social aspect to it, right, and having fun. Because, you know, you turn on the TV, you hear about charities trying to raise money for, you know, kids who are hungry in India and in South America, and you have all these really sad faces. And I'm going, you know, sad faces, yeah, but, you know, have you ever been to India or have you ever been to, you know, to countries in Africa? Dude, seriously, these people are some of the happiest people in the world. They have nothing. They really have nothing, but they're still happy, you know, because they don't, it's like, they're still happy, right? They see all these images of, like, you know, really sad, hungry faces, right? And I'm going, you know, no, that's the wrong image. You know, that's the wrong image. I think, you know, we could all have a great time and do good. right? And, you know, tying it into the social aspect with what's going on with mobile applications and, you know, gamification and things like that, we're tying all those social trends right now and channeling all of those things, right, towards doing good. And I feel that, you know, that's a step in the right direction and just trying to get people together and you know, have fun, do good, and make the world a better place.
That's an excellent, excellent cause. Excellent. It's just that's a real, real worthy a cause that you have there. A lot of people, they're looking for something, you know, to put their time and effort into, and they're looking for causes and where they can actually, you know, lend some of their time and their help, and they can't. They can't find it. They don't know where to even begin looking, and an app like yours is exactly what's needed. I'm on your site right now, and when did you go live?
So the way this whole thing came about was when I, you know, started really. So I had this idea right throughout last year. I was talking about it with a lot of people, and I just didn't go build it right. And everyone I get talking to, they're telling me, hey, you know, this is a great idea, you know, great idea. But, you know, when I went to South by Southwest this year, I actually did a demo because I actually started building the site sometime in February. And by the time March came around for South by, I had a working prototype, and I took that and I did a demo over there. And that's where it was carried by CNN and a couple other actually give them exclusive rights to do a preview of the app, which they did, and it was really awesome.
Okay, nice.
But then after I came back from South by, I launched it in a private beta because it wasn't really ready to get like the entire world in. So I had this private beta with a group of people who had signed up, just to sort of work out the bugs and get some input. So that went through up until last week. Last week, Monday, I launched the first version of the site. So right now it's live. It's live, and, you know, you can go over there and you can actually start posting things. So the cool thing about the site is, you know, you can actually create a cause, right? And it's very specific. So the cool thing about it also is, you know, it's not like, hey, there's something going on here. No, it's really about, you know, there's something going on here, and here is A, B, C, D things that we need. Here is A, B, C, D things that you can do, right? It's not just coming out and hanging out, right? You know, they're very specific. You can come out and know exactly what you want to do, right? So you can go there, you can create something, and, you know, once you do that, it's right now tied into Facebook. We're at some point going to integrate it with literally all the social networks, so it's amplified. And also the interesting feature about it is, you know, all the events and causes are geotagged. So that means basically it knows its location and where, right? The mobile applications are not ready yet. That's what I'm currently working on. And when they are ready, you can literally walk around with your mobile phone and it tells you exactly how far you are from the closest thing. So you start to see the things that are happening around you. And you know, as the site gets popular, it will start getting populated with all these things, and you could be all over wherever you go, and it's always following you. So it just knows where you are. Right now, you can set it to default to say around 10 or 20 miles radius of where you are, and it can just kind of show you all the things that are happening. If there's anything happening, if there's nothing happening, it tells you, hey, you know, there's really nothing happening. If you're really passionate about doing something, you could actually create something, right? And you know, you give the location of where that thing will happen, that event will happen, and, you know, the cause you're trying to do and what you need people to do. And then, you know, you could amplify it on the other social networks like Facebook, Twitter, G+, Google+, and so that's the idea, basically. The idea is really geotagged causes that knows what people are. And so this is what we have right now on the site is, you know, the very initial version. There's a lot of really cool what I call offerment that we're planning and building into it. And it'll be coming up, you know, over the next few weeks and months. One of the really interesting things I would just say would be you can set goals for yourself, right? So if you really want to do something, you can set a goal for yourself and say, hey, you know, this month I want to give up, you know, 20 hours of my time or 10 hours of my time or 5 hours or 1 hour of my time doing something. And, you know, you put that, you give that input, right? So the app will suggest to you how you can meet that goal. And if you don't meet the goal, it kind of lets you know, hey, you know, you said you were going to do this stuff. You haven't done it yet. This is what you've done. Here's how you can complete the rest of it, you know? So it's just sort of a very motivational thing to keep you and to keep you sort of reminded about the goals that you accept for yourself. And if you think about it also, at the end of the year, it's like you get your W-2 that states how much, you know, how much money you've made. There's going to be something that tells you how much good you've done as well. So,
gotcha.
So you know, if you feel you're not doing enough, you know, it will just, like, give you motivation to do more. Let you know, hey, you know, the next year, you can do a lot more and enjoy and have fun and make good friends while doing this thing.
I like it. It's really an extension of and like you described earlier, it's really an extension of you, of your life, because you're a very motivated person, very self-determined person, and this app actually gives a person the ability to be motivated. You know, it actually helps them to become motivated about a cause. And like you said, once you implement the feature to allow them to set goals, I mean, that's just further, you know, motivation for them. And so it's definitely an extension. And I see a lot of people now. The causes that have been created on here, are these real causes that I'm seeing scrolling up and down, or?
Yeah, whatever you see there are real things. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent. So there's already, you know, a lot of people on here creating causes and excellent.
Another interesting thing as well is, you know, it's not just it's all over the world, right? You know, so I think last time I went in there, I had a couple guys from Finland, from London, who were like doing stuff already, and it was really cool just to see people from all over just, you know, posting stuff already.
Excellent. Now, the expansion of this can be, you know, where do you see this expanding to? Because I mean, you can. You can push this to, you know, all types of, I guess, you know, places that, you know, need volunteers.
So that's our next phase. So our next push basically is now to, you know, to get all the organizations now, because, you know, this has been a problem. The funny thing was, you know, the initial problem. So if I take it back to how this particular app started, right? Back in 2006, you know, when we got married, you know, on Christmas Day, you know, we woke up and we tried to go volunteer at a hospital in Dallas at the time. You know, we spent like a few hours just calling around, and we couldn't really get a hospital to tell us, you know, how we can volunteer. And I was like, that's insane. Like, we want to give up our Christmas, right, to do something good. And they couldn't tell us. I'm like, there's got to be a better way for this, right? So if you think about organizations who are having some problems, right, you know, either organizations who are trying to raise money for charity by having all these events and things like that, but, you know, they have literally nobody show up just because either people don't know about the right people. This is like a really simple way to get people and get volunteers to. So the next big push we're doing right now is really, you know, getting all those charities and organizations to sign up. It's a free app. It costs them no money, you know. But the thing is, they start putting things out there, and it amplifies their story. You know, it amplifies their causes. And you know, they could reach out to a whole set of volunteers who are in close proximity to the events that they're trying to do. And as a matter of fact, I think I saw a couple in there already, and I'm like, wow, you know, that's really awesome.
Nice.
You know, I haven't reached out to them. You know, somehow they found it and they're already posting things out there. So it's really awesome. I mean, that's the whole point, right? Just to get people, more people to come do stuff. And, you know, if you think about these organizations, you know, they're cash strapped. So a lot of them cannot afford to really go hire IT, you know, software engineers to go build, you know, go build stuff like this for them. So, you know, there's a value add for them, right? There's a value proposition we're bringing to the city, right? You know, we've already built out a platform that they can use to further their goals without them spending the money, you know, trying to do the same thing, you know? And at that point, you know, Personify will be the marketplace where all of these things are happening. So I once described it as the Craigslist for opportunities. So, you know, I'm here now inviting all organizations, all nonprofits, and all charitable organizations to come to Personify and post your causes. It's free, absolutely free. And we are actually going to be building something really special and awesome, specific for organizations. Look out for that in the next few weeks and months.
Now, are you the only developer?
So right now there's a couple of us actually. I'm the lead in this, and I worked with. So interestingly, you know, I actually have a global team, right? I'm here in Seattle. I have a co-founder and a product management guy, a business development guy in Helsinki, Finland. My UX engineer is in Dublin, Ireland. And my animation engineer is in Brazil. So, you know, we're globally dispersed, which is really awesome because, like I said, you know, what we're building is a global marketplace. That's what we did. So I really wanted to bring in elements of people I have met and worked with, you know, around the world to bring in facets of their lives into Personify.
Nice. You
literally feel connected to, you know, doesn't matter where you are, where you're from, you can feel connected and have something meaningful for you in Personify.
Nice. So getting into some of the technical aspects of Personify, what platform did you build Personify on?
My technology stack basically is LAMP. So LAMP standing for Linux. And it runs on the Amazon cloud, basically. And that's the reason why, you know, I could literally be anywhere in the world and you know, work on it. So everything runs out there. And
So you're coding in PHP.
It's all based using PHP and Zend and what. It is a really awesome framework to build, you know, web apps. There's going to be a couple more things we'll be working on when we start scaling the application. But for now, you know, we are in a LAMP stack.
So being that you guys are globally dispersed, what type of are you, as far as being able to manage projects, what are you guys using for that?
So there's a Scrum tool. There's a Scrum tool we use actually. It's funny enough, it's actually built by another startup that was an ex Nokia guy, based in Finland. So it's really cool. A really cool project management, software. And obviously, you know, we do a lot of Skype calls. So people have been asking me basically how I keep track with all these people around the world, and I'm going, you know, the interesting thing is I don't know of any other way to work, because since I left college, I've been working in these global environments, right, where half my team was in China, another half was, you know, another group were in India, another group were in London, another group in Finland, and one in Dallas, one in, you know, in Silicon Valley, and then the other in Boston. So I've always been in that environment, right? So I don't know of any other way to work. I've learned from a very early time in my career how to really have cross-functional and globally diverse teams.
Excellent. Well, it's definitely personifies definitely an excellent cause, and we definitely look forward to seeing more development within the site itself.
Rest assured, we are working on some really, really awesome features. So.
Excellent. And that's at www.personify.it for those out there who want to check out the website and join up and put your causes out there if you have any. So this is definitely a great app. It's definitely a great cause. Definitely happy that you were able and thankful that you were able to, you know, jump on this podcast with me tonight and tell us about it. What other things, let me see, for people who want to, I always like to ask people this, what advice would you give anyone who wanted to get started in software development?
Yeah, that's a very, very good one, actually. You know, personally for me, a lot of the things I do right now, right, are, you know, things I really learned on the fly. Well, you could say perhaps because I already had the background. So, yeah, that might be true. But in all honesty, I think if you really have a drive, the Internet is a very, very great source to find anything, right? I don't really read books. That's because, you know, I kind of find that boring, you know. I'm always online doing research, finding out, you know, all the things I need to find out. So for someone who want to, you know, get into software development, if you don't have the background, there's a really cool site now called Code Academy. Code Academy. You can go there, and I think they have some really beginner courses, right, for people who don't have any software background. Right? You can go there, and that's a great resource to get started. If you're really, really motivated, there's tons and tons of places online where you can just go search. So basically what you need to do, right, it depends on what – there's a lot of, you know, facets of software development. So if you want to do web development, you know, that's one area. If you want to do mobile development, that's another area. These days people are getting more into mobile side because, you know, as you know, that's literally where the future is going. So
yeah.
You need to figure out what platforms you need first. I do use a lot of PHP Zend right now just because, you know, it's really easy to get started on. There are lots of people who are really into Ruby, or lots of people,
yeah,
if you're on the Microsoft side, you're into the .NET side of things. So, you know, it's kind of like different languages, right? You just got to choose the one that you feel you can get started with. I highly recommend Ruby or PHP. Probably PHP because, you know, I think for a beginner, PHP is probably a very good way to get started. I'm not really much of a Microsoft spec technology. I've never really used .NET, so I can't really speak much about it, but those who have used it basically give it very good reviews. But, you know, all of these are open source technologies, so it really costs you no money to go buy the software stack, basically. You know, lots of resources online. You know, talk to people, talk to, you know, software folks, engineers who are, you know, already doing these things. I'm sure, you know, there are people out there who can, you know, help you and tutor you and, you know, guide you along the right direction.
Excellent. Well, again, I want to definitely thank you for jumping on the podcast with me tonight. Definitely very inspirational story, a very worthy cause with Personify and your background, and, you know, is very motivational for a lot of people who will be listening to this podcast, me especially. I mean, when I read your bio, I was kind of just blown away. Like, this is incredible. Mm-hmm. So Definitely. No problem. I always like to invite people who appear on the podcast to join the Blacks in Technology community site. It's a free site. It's free to join. We have close to 600 members nationwide. And the cool thing about it, and that I like to tell people, is that we talk tech. So when you visit the site and you check out the forums that we have and the questions and the things that we post, it's definitely technology related. We're talking about software development, we're talking about networking, we're talking about cloud computing, we're talking about all aspects of technology. So it's definitely a good place to go and socialize with other Black technologists. A good mm-hmm. place to share your knowledge as well, share your experiences. I mean, in the end, that's what it's all about. It's about creating this very very good and growing community, so that generations after, people after us can see someone or see, something that they can, that they can go to and they can be a part of with people that, that basically walk, talk like them. And, mm-hmm. They have that vision, they have that visibility, and they are able to see, people who look like them. And so now they can aspire to be the next, Chuks. that's what it's all about. So I always like to invite the guests that I have on the show to come and be a part of the community and partake in what we're trying to build there. Like I said, there's close to 600 members now that we have on the site, and it's steadily growing. So.
Right. I think that's awesome. I really think what you're doing is really amazing. I guess for me personally, one of the biggest things when I got here first and realizing that I was literally the only one that looked like me in most of my engineering classes. Being an immigrant to the United States, I didn't understand that initially. Until I really started, understanding more of the dynamics of the U.S. It goes more or less, what you're trying to do. If you see more people who look like you, it will give you more motivation to think that there's probably something for you there. So
exactly. Very well put. Very well put. So definitely, come to the site, join up. Engage with people on the site. I mean, there's people talking about, different aspects of technology all the time. I mean, that's kind of what we do. And there's actually, this is a good time to mention that coming pretty soon also, I'm going to be releasing another aspect or another extension of the site called the Bit Tech Digest. Of course, BIT stands for Blacks in Technology, and what that is it's going to be sort of like an online magazine of sorts, tech magazine, with articles written by all Black technologists and subject matter experts, their discipline. So, anything from Linux to, software development to web development, to networking, to mobile, anything, within technology, we're going to have a category and we're going to have people that write articles on that specific topic. It's as far as I know, I haven't seen anything like it on the web. So it's definitely something that's going to hopefully give the Black technologists a huge boost as far as visibility. That's mainly what I'm all about, is creating that visibility and creating that image And so, you know, the Bit Tech Digest is definitely going to be coming soon.
Awesome, awesome. I'll look out for it.
Okay. Thanks again for joining me tonight, and good luck in the, you know, with all your endeavors.
Thank you. Thanks, and nice talking to you also.
All right. Take care.
All right. Thanks. Bye now.
Bye.
Blacks in technology.
Blacks in technology. Blacks in technology. Blacks in technology. Blacks in technology. Blacks in technology.